Hey guys, welcome back to another video in my series on applied game design. In this video, we're going to talk about how games relate to cognitivism. So this video is the second in a three-part series on how educational paradigms relate to game design. Now, the idea here is that you would get some idea of how applied games, and in particular educational games, fit in when it comes to learning theory. So previously, we looked at behaviorism and how games can leverage it for a variety of outcomes. In this video, though, we'll take a closer look at cognitivism. So cognitivism is a paradigm that understands and optimizes learning as a function of mental processes. Cognitivists will look at these processes as they are ongoing in our brain while we are learning. Things like recognizing, analyzing, recalling, evaluating, applying, creating, and so on. Now, looking at learning in this light, cognitivists feel that to optimize learning, we need to make new information and skills acquisition as digestible as possible for our brain's architecture and the mental processes that come with it. For example, if your brain is wired to speak English all day, well, then it's probably best to teach you in English. If, on the other hand, your brain is wired to learn best in Dutch, well, then geven we je gewoon les in het Nederlands. However your brain learns best, that is how we should teach you. It's all about data optimization and matching it with your brain's architecture. For example, take this human information processing diagram from Cart, Moran, and Newell from 1983. While it's not meant to reflect the actual anatomy of the human brain, it is used as an abstraction of how it functions. Say we feed some information into it. A simplified explanation for it would be that information comes in through our senses and gets stored in short-term memory. Then it is processed through a variety of processors that interact with our working memory and long-term memory, draining our attention, and resulting in a physical response to our muscles, which feeds back into our senses. Now sure, that might not be how the brain is actually put together, but it does give us some idea of how it functions. And more importantly, if we can understand the inner workings of these processes, we can optimize how information travels through them. And that's why cognitivism is sometimes referred to as the information processor view on learning. Now, if we bring that slide back and I replace a couple of these words, well, all of a sudden this diagram pretty much looks like the inside of your laptop. The senses become input, the muscles becomes your monitor, and in between we find all kinds of memory and a couple of processors. So from the lens of the cognitivist paradigm, learning is not as much about rewards and punishments and outward behavior as it is about optimizing information to efficiently move through the inner workings of your brain. So that means it's time to look at some theories and introduce you to three of my buddies. First off, we have Jean Piaget with his stages of cognitive development. Then we have Frederic Bartlett, who will talk about schema theory. And finally, there's John Sweller and cognitive load theory. So first up, Jean Piaget. Now, Piaget is one of the greatest minds of all time when it comes to child education, and his ideas are typically bigger than just the cognitivist umbrella. However, if you remember last video, I discussed Albert Bandura and social learning theory as part of behaviorism. Now, if you look at that theory again, you'll notice that the modeling process that he uses in this theory is actually very similar to how cognitivists map out the human brain and its architecture. Therefore, Bandura could just as well be considered a cognitivist. In the end, great minds often look at the world from a multitude of angles, and that's why a lot of the times their ideas can fit under multiple paradigms. Anyways, let's have a look at Jean Piaget and his stages of cognitive development. Now, I'm sure that you've noticed that you're a lot smarter than a child. Or at least I hope you have. But as we grow from infancy to adulthood, our brains grow with us and so do our cognitive abilities change. And Piaget actually defined different stages of human cognitive development. Similar to how different Pokemon evolutions have different abilities, say Pichu, Pikachu, Raichu, we also have different cognitive abilities as we advance through Piaget's evolutions. I mean, stages. From 0 to 2 years old, we are in the sensorimotor stage in which our behavior is entirely dependent on our senses. That means that if we cannot sense something, it no longer exists.
10-month-old Simon is about to make a classic mistake, known as the A not B error. Although he watched us place the toy plane under the white cloth, he'll look for it where he last found it, not where he watched us hide it.
From 2 to 7 years old, we are in the preoperational phase in which we are egocentric little brats who can't take on any alternate points of view.
Here, the adult and child sit at opposite sides of the table. They can see one side of the mountain scene in front of them. Once they've had a chance to look at the mountain, the adult asks the child to point to which of the four mountain scenes that the adult can see. This requires children to think about the mountain scene from another person's perspective. Often, younger children, like 5-year-old Braden, they point to the mountain scene that corresponds with their own perspectives of the mountains and not the adult's.
Now, from 7 to 12 years old, we are in the concrete operational phase. In this phase, we can do some logical thinking, but everything still has to be right in front of us.
Does that look like the same amount of Play-Doh? Each one's the same one?
Okay. I'm gonna go like this. Wash it down like that.
Now, does that look like it's the same amount still? Which one's more?
That one.
Are they still the same?
Yeah, because it's all you did was just smash it down. It didn't change.
And then finally, from 12 years and up, we are in the formal operational stage in which we can do abstract thought, deductive reasoning, and we can tackle complicated problems from a multitude of angles.
If you hit a glass with a feather, the glass will break.
No, it won't.
And this is the second rule. Don hit a glass with a feather. What happened to the glass?
Nothing.
Nothing happened? Why didn't anything happen?
Because the feather was soft.
If you hit a glass with a feather, the glass will break. Okay. And the second one, Don hit a glass with a feather. What happened to the glass?
It broke.
And why did it break?
Because the rule says if you hit a glass with a feather, it'll break. So if you hit a glass with a feather, it broke.
And those are the four stages of cognitive development according to Piaget. Now, those are very useful if you're a teacher or a game designer that is going to work with kids. For example, don't give a 6-year-old game mechanics that require abstract thought because they're not going to be able to process them. But what about teaching adults? Well, in comes Frederic Bartlett with his schema theory. So Bartlett's work looks at the green boxes in the human information processing diagram as he studied how memory works. Now, his most famous study involves a Native American folktale called A War of Ghosts, in which the participants had to recall the story later on during the year. Now, he noticed that the recall was typically imperfect and that his participants would fill in some of the details with their own cultural norms and expectations. In other words, your memory realigns new information with what it already thinks to know, which led to the development of schema. Schemata, which is the plural for schema, are cognitive patterns, like this one for mathematical knowledge, that organize categories of information and the relationships between them. It's our own simplified view of the world in our heads that will help us recall information, modify our behavior, and basically make sense of the world. Okay, so let's have an example. Let me read you a paragraph. The procedure is actually quite simple. First, you arrange them into different groups. Of course, one pile might be sufficient depending on how much there is. If you have to go somewhere else due to lack of facilities, then that would be the next step. Otherwise, you are set. It is important not to overdo it. In fact, it is better to do too few things at once than too many. In the short run, this might not seem important, but complications can easily arise, which could prove to be quite expensive. After the procedure is completed, one arranges the materials into different groups again, then they can be put in their appropriate places. Eventually, they will be used once more, and the cycle has to be repeated. Alright, silliness aside, did that make sense to you? If it did, well, good for you, but it's far more likely than it didn't. And if that's the case, let me fix that with 6 simple words. I was talking about doing laundry. Now, that paragraph contained a lot of words that can be connected to a lot of different concepts. Pile, facilities, complications, expensive, groups. But now that you know that it's about laundry, you can connect them to the correct scheme and it all makes sense in your brain. So learning becomes a lot easier if you understand how pre-existing knowledge is structured and how new information is assimilated with it. Speaking of bringing in new information, here's another theory. Cognitive load theory by John Sweller is a great example of cognitivism as it really pinpoints what human cognition is capable of. If you think back to that slide of human information processing, cognitive load is all about one of those boxes, the working memory. You see, cognitive load refers to the amount of information that a human is trying to process in their working memory at one time. Now, the interesting thing about that is that John Sweller figured out that the working memory actually has limitations to it. If we keep cramming information in it, we can overload it, which basically means that we will forget bits and pieces of the information, and we will continue to process it without actually taking everything into account. Now, what's really spectacular about the theory is that John Sweller figured out how big our working memory actually is. The maximum amount of chunks of information that we can process at one time is 7 plus or minus 2, so approximately somewhere between 5 or 9. But what is a chunk exactly? Well, a chunk is a bit of information that you can process at one time. Let me do a little experiment with you to show you how that works. Well, we have an empty screen for now, but in a second, I'm going to show you two sequences of characters. Try to memorize them and then ask yourself, which one is easier to recall? So let's take a look at this. Following cognitive load theory, the second sequence should be easier to recall. It has far fewer chunks for most people. You see, the first sequence for most people would be about 12 chunks, since none of these letters are processed in one go. If, however, you're like me and you know of the IBM Corporation, the Esports League, and the United States of America, the second sequence could only be 6 chunks, which makes it far more manageable to process. Heck, if you're a Western Oregon University alum, you might be able to even drop it to 4 chunks. And that is how cognitive load theory can help you structure information in a way that is easier to process by your working memory. And that's my third and final theory on cognitivism. Now, as game designers, we can use these theories to develop game design guidelines. For example, let's take a look at a game that applies these things pretty well. This is Plants vs. Zombies. So let's assume a player who has never played this game before, and we are considering their schemata to make it easier for them to learn the game. It's reasonable to assume that they know how their hardware and interface works, and that they can click on objects. However, any other information and skill will need to be assimilated with those schemata, basically turning mouse clicks into gathering sun and planting plants. Plants vs. Zombies opening level explains this in detail, step by step. The game also factors cognitive load theory, reducing the amount of information that needs to be processed at one time to a bare minimum. In the opening, there's only one lane of grass, one zombie type, one type of plant. At the sum mechanic, and there are only 4 chunks of information to deal with. As the game advances, the information that the player needs to have assimilated in their schemata has expanded quite a bit. In fact, the game now features an encyclopedia of plants and zombies, all with different abilities. However, the game matches the mechanics of the plants with the scheme of an actual plant. Sunflowers scatter sun, melons are heavy ballistics, walnuts have protective shells, and peppers burn the heart out of your opponents.
I will burn the heart out of you.
Furthermore, most levels force you to pick up to 9 or 7 plus 2 plants so that the amount of plants that you choose from is right at the edge of your working memory. And by building up your schemata carefully while playing the game, you eventually become skilled enough so that you can beat Dr. Zomboss, a final level in which you get random plants to defeat random zombie types. Where you originally dealt with small goals that could be conquered through procedural steps, you are now ready to face complex problems that are presented as a whole. And that's a pretty great way to learn. So anyways, like behaviorism, cognitivism is far from perfect, even if their empirical research is pretty sound. However, cognitivists struggle with the subjectivity of learning, as they see knowledge as something that's subjective and external to the learner. After all, once you understand how the human brain works, you can apply it to all humans, right? Well, that's not always the case. You see, you might feel that a chihuahua is a dog, but I know somebody who would disagree.
Any dog under 50 pounds is a cat, and cats are pointless.
Now, of course, Ron Swanson's schemata are obviously well-developed enough to know that there are dogs under 50 pounds, and that's why the joke works. However, if you're a kid that has grown up around very big dogs, you might get confused at the sight of a chihuahua. You might even think it's a rat. In the end, facts are objective, but knowledge oftentimes has a subjective side to it. And as teachers and game designers, we have to take that into account. Otherwise, our would-be learners might reject new information, and you end up with people who are rejecting reasonable precautions in the midst of a pandemic. Oh, Reggie, I'm sorry. I didn't call you a rat. That was Ron Swanson. You're a dog. Wanna be friends? friends. So in this video, we talked about the importance of understanding how we process information so that we can use that understanding to optimize our designs and become more effective at teaching people. Say, for example, you're recording some videos to teach people online. You might want to put some funny bits in left and right so you don't overload your students' attention spans.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained?
And that's the end of this video, Reggie. Again, make sure to check out the communication platform of this class to connect with me, the other students, and, well, Reggie here. And if you need some points of discussion, here are some ideas. See you next time.